Hello everyone and welcome. Let's have a brief discussion on a few questions from final accounts chapter of profit oriented units, and we are going to take up questions from RTP of May and November 2020 of CA Foundation. Now this chapter is applicable for CMA Foundation and intermediate level also, so it can be useful for those students as well. So without any delay, let's get into the questions. First question, the following are the balances extracted from the books of Sri Raghuram as on 31st March 2018, who carries on business under the name and style of Messrs. Raghuram and Associates at Chennai. Trial balance is given to us. We have debit and credit, capital account purchases, purchases, returns, sales, all those are given, discount allowed, discount received. So I'm not going to read through all the expenses, but just briefly go into what is given to us. We have stock as on 31st March. That is important point here. That is what we had to just check. Stock as on 31st March 2017. The trial balance is as of 31st March 2018. So, ideally speaking, we are supposed to prepare the final accounts of year ended 31st March 2018. So, in that trial balance, if 31st March 2017 stock is given, it means that it is opening stock. Now, there is no other stock given in the question. So, which means it is an indication that closing stock will be given as a adjustment figure out of trial balance. Now, if closing stock was already given within the trial balance, even if purchases were just recorded as purchase of the ledger, if it just used the name purchases also, it would still mean adjusted purchases, wherein from purchases you eliminated the stock amount and posted it to another ledger called closing stock. So to just verify that, always ensure in your trial balance you do not have the closing stock figure. If you have the closing stock figure within the tally trial balance, it means from purchases there has been a removal and then the closing stock ledger has been separately opened. Now, if that process is not done and closing stock is given as an out of book adjustment, then you will have closing stock effect recorded in two places, one in trading account and another in balance sheet. Now, if closing stock was already given within the trial balance itself, in the tally trial balance, then it means closing stock will have only one effect, that is to balance sheet, because trading account, whatever effect was there, it would have already been taken into account while recording purchases accounts. So make sure when you take a final accounts question, think about the closing stock figure, where does it appear. If it appears within the trial balance, take closing stock figure only into balance sheet. If closing stock appears after trial balance as an adjustment, take it to trading account as well as balance sheet. Yeah. So please remember these two important points. And then certain expenses, assets are all given and it's a tallied trial balance. Next, they are continuing with a question. Prepare trading and profit and loss account for the year ended 31st March 2018 and the balance sheet as at that date after making provision for the following. Depreciation is given for certain assets. Value of stock at the close of the year was 410,000, which is nothing but the closing stock that we were discussing just now. 1 month rent for godown is outstanding. Interest on loan from Rajan is payable at 10% per annum. This loan was taken on so and so day. Provision for bad debts is to be maintained at 5% of sundry debtors. Insurance premium includes 42,000 towards proprietor's life insurance policy and the balance of insurance charges cover the period from 1st April 2017 to 30th June 2018. So let's quickly prepare trading account, and as and when we go ahead with the preparation, we can prepare any working note whenever required. So trading and profit and loss account. Thank you. Now you can have two columns. One is the outer column, which will have all the information which has to be tallied up and found the balancing figures. You can also have an inner column, which will show all these additions and subtraction of returns and all those things. But you can even prepare one amount column, and all those inner column computations can be done within the particular. So I'm going to follow that part, wherein all computations, if any, I'll just do it in the particular section. So we have to start trading account with opening stock. So to opening stock, given in the trial balance, 3,20,000 rupees. So 3,20,000. Then trading account, the next point is purchases. Now in this trial balance, we have purchases and purchases return. So we will show the net purchases in outer column. Now there is another presentation technique also, wherein total purchases will be shown on the debit side of trading and purchases returns will be shown on the credit side. So whichever way you have learned or which you feel is comfortable, you can go ahead and use it. But generally in suggested answer or in your study materials, you are going to see the net purchases after adjusting for all returns being shown in amount column as a single amount. Yeah? So we are going to follow that approach. So total purchases is 12 lakh. Yeah? From here, you are supposed to reduce the returns, purchases returns, which in turn you can also say returns outward, because you're sending goods to the supplier from whom you have purchased, and purchases returns were 18,000. So 18,000, reduce that. Therefore, your net purchases is going to be 12 lakh minus 18,000, 11 lakh 82,000. And then you have sales. Sales also has sales returns, 15 lakh and 24. So sales returns also similar approach, just like you have done for purchases return. So sales inner column 15 lakh minus returns. Now this also you have another presentation of showing sales return on the debit side of trading account. That is also fine, but generally this will be the norm. So net sales is going to be 14 lakh 76 thousand. So after net sales are recorded, we now move on to the next item in trading account, which could be general, direct expenses. Now what are direct expenses? To purchase or to ensure that goods are ready for sale, whatever expenses you have incurred, that all becomes part of direct expenses. Now in the list of expenses in trial balance, we have freight inwards, which means to get something or to get some goods into your business, you have incurred certain freight expenses. So when will you incur such freight expenses? Only when you purchase goods from an outside supplier and you bring it into your godown or warehouse. So such freight inwards is also a direct expense, because only if you get the goods into your possession, you can actually start trading in it. So therefore, freight inwards is a direct expense. Now what about freight outwards or carriage outward mentioned here? Carriage outward is nothing but when you are sending goods outside of your godown or outside from your warehouse. That happens when you are selling goods. When you are selling goods, you are supposed to send your goods out from your warehouse. So that is when carriage outwards come into picture, and therefore it is related to sales. Not when goods are made ready for sale. It is actually a part of sale being taken up or sale transaction being carried out. Therefore, carriage outwards or freight outwards will be an indirect expense taken to P&L. Whereas freight inwards or carriage inwards will be a direct expense, which ensures that goods reach your possession or your godown to ensure that you can start production or start trading in it. So freight inwards also you have recorded. Now if you quickly run through, you have carriage outwards, rent, rates, salaries, discount. All those things are indirect expenses, which are expenses for the business but not related to production activity. It is related for the business as a whole, or related for the business to carry out in its entire function. So all these are indirect expenses. So I'm roughly just reading through. You can read in detail when you are working out on your own each expenses, and ensure that you have taken every direct expenses into consideration in trading and P&L account, yeah? Trading account. Okay? so freight involved. So after reading everything, I understand that there is only one direct expense, which is freight inwards. We have record. So the next step is to record closing stock, which is 410,000 given as an additional adjustment. So if closing stock is given as an additional adjustment, it means that closing stock will have two effects, one in trading account and the other in balance sheet. So trading account, we are taking it now and we are finding out the gross profit as a balancing figure. So 14,76,000 plus 410,000 minus 3,22,000 gross profit. So this is the total of our trading account. Then we move on to P&L account by gross profit carry down. Sorry, by gross profit draw down. 3,22,000. So after recording gross profit, we can now move ahead to record all indirect expenses. Now make sure that you keep a check on whatever items you have taken off from trial balance in order to ensure that you don't repeat them again and again. Yeah, but make sure you don't make any markings in your question paper, because that is not advisable. But keep a check, mental check, or you can either just roughly check in your answer sheet that you have reduced so and so from your list of accounts in trial balance. So we move on to indirect expense, wherein carriage outwards is given. So to carriage outwards, while recording the expenses and indirect incomes, also ensure that you are taking into account all additional points related to expenses also, because here you will have expenses which are actually paid or outstanding, which were recorded as part of your journal entry ledger and then into trial balance. But additional points will be those type of journal entries or those type of transaction which has not found a place in journal ledger and trial balance, but still should be taken into account while preparing the financial statements or final accounts, trading, P&L, balance sheet. So we don't have anything related to carriage outwards. So whatever is given in the trial balance, we can take it up as it is, 8,500. Now then we move on to the next expense given to us, which is rent of gold, 55,000. Now while reading additional points, we had read about an rent of godown, outstanding additional points. So while taking into P&L account, you have to ensure this point is also considered. So rent of godown, 55,000. So rent of godown, 55,000. If it's given in trial balance and then additional point is given that 1 month for rent of go down is outstanding, what will that mean? It means that whatever is given in the trial balance would only relate to so rent expenses which are actually paid. Yeah. So if 1 month rent is outstanding, how many months rent would have been paid in the year, provided no information of previous year's outstanding is given? Such a case is not there. So we can assume this 55,000 entirely paid is for current year. But how many months were paid in current year? Only 11 months, because out 1 month is outstanding. So when trading P&L account is prepared, should you consider it on cash basis or accrual basis? You always have to record accrual basis. That is, you have to record expenses and incomes as and when you earn and incur them. It doesn't depend whether you receive it in cash or whether you would pay it in cash. It can be still outstanding or receivable. But if it's an expense or income of the current year, if you have earned it or if you have incurred it, you will have to take into consideration. So rent of go down 55,000 is only those expenses which are actually paid. And it represents 11 months, because an additional point they say that 1 month is outstanding. So we have to include that outstanding rent also to P&L, because those outstanding expenses put together with the rent actually paid only will be the sum of 12 months rent expenses, and we have to record in P&L account expenses incurred over this entire 12 months from 1st April 2017 to 31st March 2018. So outstanding expenses or outstanding rent. Now, if 55,000 was paid for 11 months, how much would have been the rent for 1 month? It would have been 5,000. So that 5,000 is my outstanding rent, and it will be added onto my rent expense, and we will show a total rent expense of 60,000. Now, this outstanding rent was the point given as additional point after trial balance. So everything that comes out of the trial balance stage or out of after this tally trial balance stage will have two effects, one in trading or P&L, the other definitely in balance sheet. Yeah. So outstanding rent, we have taken one effect in P&L account. So the other effect of this 5,000 outstanding rent will be in balance sheet, wherein you show it along with all other current liabilities. Yeah. So make sure to remember these points. So rent is recorded. Then we have rates and taxes, and no other additional point is given. You only have additional points regarding provision for bad doubtful debts, insurance premium, interest on loan and depreciation. Nothing regarding rates and taxes. So whatever is given in trial balance, you can take it as it is. To rates and taxes, 24,000. So whatever you have paid is what you have incurred in current year also. That is the assumption we take up when you do not have any additional point regarding a particular expense or income. What about salary? Salary also do not have any additional point. So entire salary, 72,000, you will take it to P&L as it is. So whatever comes in trial balance or within the tally trial balance will have only one effect. Either you take it to trading account, or you take it to P&L account, or you take it to balance sheet. Either of these three statements or accounts. But if out of book or out of trial balance comes, you will have two effects. So rates and salaries and expenses are recorded. Then you have discount allowed. Discount allowed is an expense for you. And when do you allow it? Discount allowed is when you are supposed to receive some amount and you say to that person that do not pay the entire amount, I am giving you a discount. That is an expense from the point of view of a trader. So discount allowed generally comes when a debtor starts paying us money, which is an expense. So this discount allowed, we will take it to P&L accounts, debit side. Discount allowed 7,500. Now, what about discount receipt? When will that occur? When you are paying somebody money and they say that do not pay the entire amount, we are going to give you a discount. That generally happens when we are paying our creditors. So, creditors will say that instead of paying 1 lakh, I am giving you 12,000 discount, pay me only 88,000. So, which is an indirect income, you will take to the credit side of P&L account. So, by discount received, 12,000. This happens when you are actually paying or settling an account. So it becomes an indirect expense or indirect income. Then we have drawings, which is related to my capital account. Drawings is nothing but from the initial investments or from the investments that you have made into the business, you are withdrawing certain part, which will have an effect in my capital account. So therefore, do not take into trading or P&L, right? It's not an expense. Next is printing and stationery, 6,000, nothing mentioned about it. So printing and stationery also will go to trading, P&L account, printing and stationery, 6,000. After printing and stationery, we have insurance premium. But insurance premium, we have certain information given to us. What is that? Insurance premium given in trial balance is 48,000, and additional point says those insurance premium includes 42,000 paid towards proprietor's life insurance policy. That means the owner's LIC payment is 42,000 out of that 48,000. Is it an expense for the business? No, it is an expense on the life of the proprietor, which you cannot take it to an P&L account of the business, as it's not a business expense. But have we paid it from the business money? Yes. So this payment of LIC of the proprietor will be treated as an additional drawings, not as an expense. Now, balance insurance coverage. How much will the balance be? Out of 48,000, if 42,000 is personal LIC, remaining is 6,000. That remaining 6,000, say it is said that it covers from period 1/4/2017 to 36/2018. So, since it's a bit of a computation, we will take up a working note to show the effect. Insurance premium. Given in child balance is 48,000, but out of that paid for proprietor's LIC, which will never be business expense, hence you cannot take it to P&L, which will be deducted from the expense and we will show it as an additional drawings. So balance 6,000, we can say balance insurance premium paid for business, but this 6,000 also, it is said that it covers period 1/4/2017 to 36/2018. Now, till when we are preparing the final accounts, till 31st March 2018. We have paid a premium till 36/2018. So, which means we can say that this 6,000 is actually broken into two parts. It covers 1/4/2017 till our balance sheet or final accounts preparation date of 31st March 2018, and also it extends to another 3 more months. That is 1/4/2018 to 36/2018. Now, what is this additional 3 months that we have already paid? It is a payment of premium for a future date, which we can term as nothing but prepaid insurance premium. And prepaid insurance premium, can we take it into our P&L account in current year? No. It will be taken to P&L account only in the future year when it is actually an expense. So, prepaid insurance premium, we will have to deduct from our expenses. Now, how much is the prepaid insurance premium? They do not say on what basis the 6,000 is paid. So, we have to assume the 6,000 is paid uniformly throughout the period given, which means from April 2017 to 36/2018, which means how many months? 15 months. So, based on the time proportion, we will allocate this 6,000, which is 12 months and 3 months. So, if 6,000 was paid for 15 months, how 6,000 was paid for 15 months, how much will be actual expense of 12 months? It is only 4,800. What about remaining 3 months? That is a prepaid insurance premium which will be taken to balance sheet. So I'll write that point also, taken to P&L. This one will be taken to balance sheet as a prepaid expense. So, working note number 1, and I'll give an explanation about this one also. Adjust to capital account, 42,000 for proprietor's LIC. So, insurance premium is only insurance premium. Is only 4,500. Make sure you give the reference of the working note you have taken, which is working note number 1, and amount is 4,800. So after this, let's move on to the next expense. Electricity charges, nothing mentioned about it. So electricity charges as it is, we will take 14,000. We have general expenses 11,000, taken as it is. We have bank charges 3,800. And then we have bad debts, 12,200. And a provision for bad debts also is already given in the trial balance. But provision for doubtful debts, towards the end, it is mentioned in additional point that provision for bad debts is to be maintained at 5% of debtors. So 5% of debtors meaning, what is the debtors now? 2,80,000. So how much should we maintain the provision for doubtful debts at? We have to maintain it at 14,000. But what is the provision for doubtful debts already in your trial balance, 10,000? Which means in current year, as part of journal entry and ledger posting, you have already created provision to the extent of 10,000. But you need how much? 14,000. So which means you will have to create an additional provision of 4,000. And bad debts, you already have 12,200. Now, you can all combine these two bad debts and provision for doubtful debts in one single expense, or you can split it. I prefer it in separate ledgers, because bad debts is an actual loss. We already know that it has become bad debt, but provision for doubtful debts is not an exact bad debt figure. It's an estimation. So, I prefer it to differentiate it and keep it. So, therefore, bad debts I'm going to record now. Now, if bad debts, they asked us to additionally create bad debts also, then we would have taken bad debts at a revised amount. But here, they're only talking about provision for bad debts to be maintained at a separate or required percentage. Nothing about bad debts. So, bad debt as it is, we will take it to P and L as a loss. Now, provision for doubtful debts, you have it in your trading account, but you'll have to check whether you have to increase the provision, decrease or do any adjustment. For that, let us open another working note. Working note number 2, provision for bad debts. Additional point mentions that required provision at year end or 31st March 2018 is how much? Debtors position whatever be on that 5%. So sundry debtors given in our trial balance was 2,80,000. So on that 5%, if I have to maintain provision, it will be 2,80,000 into 5%, which is 14,000. So what is already given in the trial balance provision for doubtful debts? Bad debts, 10,000. So already in trial balance provision account is 10,000, which means additional provision to be created now is 14,000 required versus already available 10,000. So we have to create an additional provision of 4,000. Now, how much will you take it to P&L as provision for bad debts? Now, 10,000 already in trial balance, you will have only one effect. Since it is within the trial balance and provision account, you will treat it as any other outstanding or current liability or provision accounts, and you will take it to balance sheet as it is. Yeah? Only one effect within the trial balance. So, this one you will take to balance sheet. What about the additional provision that you have created? That will have two effects, one in P&L and another in balance sheet. So which means as part of provision for bad debts, that is the name given in this question. So as part of provision for bad debts in P&L, you will show only this 4,000 given as an additional point. Not directly, but as part of a computation, you have arrived at this 4,000. The 10,000 already in trial balance will be taken to balance sheet as it is. Plus the 4,000 having two effects, one in P&L and one in balance sheet. So this 10,000 and the 4,000 gets added, and together 14,000 will be the core provision. You will show it in your balance sheet. Yeah, hope it is clear. Now the same computation is what is given in the RTP answers, that they have added both bad debts and provision for bad debts into one single account, and they have given the amount as a cumulative figure. Now we will just show how will we show as part of our working note done provision for bad debts. We have already said that working note number 2, 4,000, the additional provision required alone will have two effects, one in P&L and one in balance sheet. So that alone you will add. Now the same ledgers in the study material, not in the study material, in the RTP of CA Foundation, they have taken it collectively and shown as 16,200 under a single ledger provision for bad debts. Now that is also correct. This presentation is also correct. Now this presentation might be much more better, I feel, because bad debts is an actual loss, but provision for bad debts is an estimated loss. We cannot say for sure that this is the loss that is going to happen. But amount which is going to have an effect in P&L will be same. Here it is a combination of two amounts. In the RTP answers given, it's one single amount of 16,200. So whichever you feel you can relate to more in terms of the working note and conceptual clarity, go ahead and do it. But ultimately, 16,200 is what you will debit for both these ledgers put together. Yeah. So this is a slight difference you can find from the RTP answer if you go ahead and check it. So we have completed provision also. Then we have loan from Rajan, which is a liability and will be shown in balance sheet. But we have something called interest on loan. Oh, sorry. After bad debts, we had repair. So let us finish that and then come to loan. Since provision for there, I think I skipped these two. So repairs of motor vehicle 13,000. So let us record to repairs 13,000, and then we had interest on loan 4,400. Now comes the relevance of the liability loan from Rajan, that was 60,000. But there was additional point given that loan was payable at 10% per annum, and this loan was taken from 1/7/2017. So let's quickly open a working note to discuss about this interest on loan. Loan from Rajan, it was taken on 1/7/2017. That means after the year has started, after the financial year started, we took an amount of 60,000 from him. So we are supposed to pay interest at 10% per annum. Yeah. So how much should be the interest actually liable that has to be paid to Rajan? 60,000 into 10%. But the interest is per annum. But have we received this loan for the entire 12 months? No, we received it somewhere in the middle or somewhere after the year has started. So how many months actually this loan was put into the business, only for those many months we can pay him interest, otherwise it's going to be a loss for us. So we can see that from 1/4/2017 year to 31/3/2018, covering 12 months, we use this loan only from 1/7/2017, which means after 3 months of the business starting this year. So 4, 5, and 6 months were completely without using this loan. So from July 1st to 31st March, we use this loan. Therefore, we can say we put this loan to use only for 9 months. So therefore, interest will be 60,000 into 10% into 9 divided by 12, 4,500. Now, this is the interest that actually should be paid to Rajan, and this should be the expense in terms of interest on loan. But what is given in the trial balance as interest on loan? Only 4,400. What will that mean? Out of 4,500, interest paid is only 4,400. It means that the remaining 100 is an outstanding interest on loan. Yeah. So how will you show this entire interest? the entire 4,500 should be taken to P&L. Now, what about 100? 100 will be taken to balance sheet. The remaining 4,400 has actually come into the ledger and trial balance, as well as it has an effect in the bank account already, because we have shown it as an interest paid. So total interest expense, we will take 4,500, which is a combination of the amount given in the trial balance plus the outstanding 100 put together. Yeah, so therefore, interest on loan. So interest on loan already given in the question, or trial balance 4,400 plus outstanding interest 100, together 4,500. Give the working note reference also. Always make sure that when you write an answer in accounts or any other problem paper, if you have any working note or if you have any backing up or presentation wherein you want to explain how you arrived at the answer, make sure to give the reference of that working note in your main answer itself, so that the person who is valuing it finds it easy to go ahead and look at, okay, in working note number 2, it need not be even working note number 2, you can make it note 2 or whatever name you generally use it. Working note is the normal nomenclature that is being used in the study material or accounts. So therefore, we are also following that. So whatever name you are given, make sure you write it here, note 2 or note 3, so that the valuer can quickly go ahead and see that working note and say, okay, this computation is done and so is the reason why he or she has taken this answer into the main P&L account. Yeah? So we cannot write the entire thing in the main answer, it becomes very clumsy. So make sure references to working notes, if at all you are supposed to give for anything, you do it in your main answer. So interest on loan is recorded, so that is done. Provision for bad debts is done. After this, everything is assets and liabilities. So I believe we have taken up every expenses and incomes from trial balance, and additional points also we have taken: closing stock, rent, interest, provision, insurance claim, except depreciation. So that will be my final expense side. So to depreciation, that also let us take using a working note, so that it is easy for us to record it in this main answer. Working note number 4, quickly, depreciation. Now depreciation, it is mentioned 5% on building, and building is 5 lakhs. So building 5%, now it is not necessary to even do a working note for this. We can straight away do this workings within that main answer P&L itself, if you have ample space in the particulars or details in the inner amount column. So 5 lakh into 5. Now we do not know when was this building purchased, no other information is given. So when no information about any asset, fixed asset is given, we generally have an assumption that these assets were there in the business from the start of the year in which you are taking or in which you are preparing this final accounts, from 1-2017. If some special point is mentioned that so and so assets were purchased in between date, then depreciation computation gets done accordingly. But if nothing is mentioned, just the depreciation percentage and the value of these fixed assets, we assume that these fixed assets were in the business from the start of the year. So therefore, full 5% for 12 months is depreciation on building. Now what about the other assets? Furniture 10%, office equipment 15%, and motor car 20%. So furniture, we had 50,000. So furniture 50 and office equipment 2 lakh. So we can say furnitures and fittings 50,000 into 10%. This also same assumption from the start of the year. So therefore depreciation 5,000. Then we have office equipments, and the fixed asset worth was 2 lakh and the percentage of depreciation was 15%. Therefore, we can say depreciation was 30,000. And finally, we had motor car and its depreciation was 20%. And the motor car worth was motor vehicle for 1 lakh. So 20,000. So all depreciations we have computed. Now we can take the sum of it and record the cumulative figure, right? The P&L. 30,000, 60,000, 80,000. Now here itself within the inner column we can show this working note or all these computations. If it is clean and legibly, you can present it, you can do it here also. So once P&L account we have recorded everything, let's now move on to finding out the profit or loss situation of this question. So therefore, the net profit is to net profit transferred to balance sheet capital account as balancing figure is going to be 8,700. So P&L account is also complete. Now we can go ahead and open the balance sheet. What was Raghuram and Associates? When you are writing trading and P&L account, make sure to write the name of the business also at the start of it. Raghuram and Associates. I had forgotten to mention it. Please make sure that you record the entire name of the business also. It's part of the format. So Raghuram and Associates balance sheet as on 31st March 2018, liabilities amount, assets amount. We generally present the asset side based on the permanence or least liquidity position, which means fixed assets first and then on the most liquid or which can easily be converted into cash or money will be recorded at the end of it. So in that sense, fixed assets, we will first mention all fixed assets. So either you can give the heading fixed assets or you can skip that also and then start recording each and every asset. Now land and building, you had a opening balance or the balance given in the trial balance was 5 lakh, but depreciation is a expense or loss for the wear and tear when you're using these fixed assets. So which means depreciation, which was given as an out of book adjustment or out of trial balance, will have two effects, one in P&L and the second one effect will be in the fixed asset ledger for which this depreciation was actually incurred. For that reason, you will reduce the appropriate depreciations of each fixed assets accordingly and record only the net fixed asset value in the outer column. Same way, furnitures and fittings. I believe furnitures and fittings were 50,000, we reduced depreciation, we charged depreciation of 5,000. So total cost was 50,000 minus depreciation 5,000. So which means my furnitures and fixtures is worth only 45,000 now. Same way office furniture, office equipment. 2 lakh was the balance in ledger. I charged depreciation worth 30,000, so therefore my office equipment is worth only 1,70,000 now. And finally, motor vehicles, its balance was 1 lakh, And the depreciation charge in the current year was 20,000. So therefore, I can say my motor vehicle is worth only 80,000 at the end of the year when I'm preparing my balance sheet. So all fixed assets I have recorded. So after fixed assets, what all are left to be recorded? We are supposed to record debtors, closing stock, cash in bank. So ensure that whatever is in trial balance gets recorded only in one place, either in trading, either in P&L or in balance sheet. Now assets we have recorded only in balance sheet, but depreciation, since it was an out of trial balance adjustment, we recorded it in P&L as well as in balance sheet respective to each fixed assets for which it was actually incurred. So after recording fixed assets, the next we will record is sundry debtors. Now sundry debtors is 2,80,000. Sundry debtors can be presented in two ways. 2,80,000 assets you can show it here, and a provision which you have created for the sundry debtors can be shown on the liability side. Another presentation is sundry debtors, you will show the amount in inner column, and the provision, even though it's a separate ledger, you want to show it related to the asset for which this provision was created. And hence you can reduce from here and show the net amount in outer column. Both presentations are fine, but I will show it as provision on liability side and sundry debtors as such on asset side. So therefore 2,80,000. Then we have closing stock. Now closing stock, 4,10,000 was given out of trial balance, and first effect we took it in trading account, second effect we are taking it in balance sheet. So stock is also recorded. Then we have cash in bank and cash in hand, 22,16,000. That gets recorded at the end of the cash in bank and cash in hand. But make sure you don't forget to write one more expense, which was a prepaid insurance premium that you have done. It is an expense payment you have done for a future year, which when considering preparation of assets and liabilities of current year, you can say it's an asset for you because you have paid in advance for it. So prepaid insurance premium or insurance charges 1,200. Just check in working notes whether you have left any such assets like prepaid insurance premium to be taken to balance sheet. We have an outstanding loan which is not an asset, which is a liability. So asset side we have recorded everything. Liability side we generally record the capitals first. But when you are writing capital account, you adjust the net profit, drawings, everything from capital account. So this capital account, you can either show it as a working note computation, or you can show within the inner column itself. Let us show it in the inner column. Now capital account, 14,11,400 is what they see as the balance given in trial balance. We have a ledger called drawings in our trial balance, which is actually withdrawal of an investment made into the business, which ultimately gets adjusted into our capital account. So 20,000 I'll reduce from my capital. Then anything else that get adjusted in my capital account? We had something called insurance premium paid towards proprietors LIC, which when taking up insurance premium expense, we had mentioned about it. This 42,000 will get adjusted to capital account just like another drawings. But here the only difference is this 42,000 drawings, we specifically know for what reason, for proprietors LIC. That is also in the nature of another drawing. So proprietors LIC payment also we have reduced from capital. Then you have to add the current profit or loss. In current year, it is a profit to the extent of 8,700. 100, so that gets added to my capital account. Now nothing else. So let us take up the total of this capital account. So we can say our capital account balance is 13,58,100. 13,58,100. Then we have all liabilities to mention. What are the liabilities? We have loan from Mr. Rajan 60,000, sundry creditors 62,000. So let us record loan from Rajan 60,000, sundry creditors 62,000. Then we have two more items, I believe. One is the provision for bad debts, which we say should be shown as part of your liability. Either that is the presentation or from asset side, sundry letters you can adjust. That is your choice. So since we have not adjusted it from letters, we will now show it as part of liability. Then we have the interest on loan, 100 rupees outstanding. Is there anything else in the nature of a liability? Nothing else. So then we can show provision for bad debts. 10,000 already in trial balance, plus additional provision, plus 4,000. So 4,000, which we took it to P&L, will have two effects, one in P&L, one in balance sheet. 10,000 already in trial balance will have only one effect in balance sheet. To specify or to stress on that point, I have showed this bifurcation. And finally, interest on loan outstanding. So now we have recorded all assets and liabilities. So let us see whether our balance sheet gets tallied or not. I have not recorded one more outstanding. It's outstanding rent along with interest on loan outstanding. We had rent outstanding also. 5%. So let me just check now. 4,75,000 plus 45,000. $14,99,200 is my balance sheet total. Now, if provision for bad debts you have shown as a deduction from debtors account, the total will be different, but you will have a tally balance sheet. So, depending upon that presentation difference, the totals can vary, but otherwise, the answer will be correct. So, this is how you will take up question number 1, and this question was given in your May 2020 RTP. Now let us take up November 2020 RTP, similar type of question, but this question has another feature to it, wherein a rectification of errors was also asked as part of this question. So the following is the trial balance of T on 31st March 2019. Capital is given, drawings, fixed assets. If you can see, you have two ledgers. So here is what I have said in the previous question also, the bifurcation. If nothing is mentioned, just fixed assets or the bifurcation of all fixed assets without any dates, we can assume that these fixed assets were from the start of the year. But if some additional point on purchases or sales of fixed assets has to be given, it will either be given in the additional point or adjustment, or just like here, just like this trial balance, we are in opening fixed assets, that is the fixed assets that were available with us from the start of the year is given, and also the list of fixed assets or the total of fixed assets that I have purchased during the year. Addition is nothing but I have added on to the fixed asset collection that I have already have, which means it's another purchase of fixed assets. Opening stock, purchases, debtors, creditors, expenses, fixed assets. We here have suspense account. So which means suspense account is already in trial balance. So this is a case of an adjusted trial balance case. Adjusted trial balance case. So after preparing the trial balance, posting this difference into suspense account, we are now going to rectify the reasons for this suspense and then preparing the financial statements. Rent, all those information is given. Only with the help of the suspense account will the trial balance get tallied. So since it's a tally trial balance with the help of suspense, we can say it's an adjusted trial balance. So stock as on 31st March 2019, day of this final trial balance, that is the closing stock, is 1 lakh. Depreciation to be 10% on fixed assets purchased during the year. A scrutiny of books of account revealed the following matters. 20,000 withdrawn from bank was debited to joint account, but out of this amount withdrawn, 12,000 was used in the business for day-to-day expenses. Yeah. Then purchase of goods worth 16,000 was not recorded in the books of accounts up to 31/3/2019, but the goods were not included in, were included in stock. So that means while taking the closing stock physical valuation, we included these goods, but it did not get added into the purchases ledger, which means the purchase amount shown in the trial balance is incorrect. But the closing stock figure at the end of the year is after taking into consideration this purchases also. That might be because this purchases was omitted to be recorded as an entry, but when the physical goods came in, that were stored along with all the other stocks. So when physical counting of closing stock was done, this also got added up. Then purchase returns of 1,000 was recorded in sales return journal, and the amount was correctly posted to the party's account on correct side. So that is, there was a purchase return. Purchase return should have a credit balance, but instead of recording it in purchase return journal, we recorded it in sales return journal. And from sales return journal, where will it go? It will go to sales return. When it goes to sales return, ideally speaking, the party account should also have been incorrect. So when I record in sales return journal, entry would have been sales return has a debit balance. So I should have debited sales return and credited the party. This should have been done. But they say that party account was correctly posted. What is this correctly posted? It was initially a purchase return case. So initially it should have been party account debit to purchase returns. So instead of showing in this purchase returns ledger or journal book, I posted it in sales return. But even though I posted it in sales return book or journal, I can say, I did not make an error in posting the party's account, which should have been debit had it been correctly taken to purchase. So party account was correctly debited. Maybe the mentioned ledger was sales return, but I have debited. So that party account got correctly posted. Then where was the error? Instead of posting into purchase returns, I posted to sales return. So the error has occurred only in the sales return ledger, which was posted from the sales return journal. So only error in sales return ledger, not in party account. So we have to make that correction also. Then expenses include 6,000 in respect of the period after 31st March 2019. Give the necessary journal entries in respect of 1 to 4 and prepare the final accounts for the year ended 31st March 2019. So that is what they are asking us to do. to prepare the rectification entries and then go ahead with the trial balance to prepare P&L account. So let us start with the rectification entries first. Rectification entries, give them in the books of T. Make sure you write that in the books of the journal entries or rectification entries. Give the proper heading. The first error was 20,000 withdrawn from bank was debited to drawings account. So entry would have been drawings account debit to bank. But out of this amount withdrawn, 12,000 was used in the day-to-day expenses. So ideally speaking, out of the 20,000 withdrawal done from bank, only 8,000 was drawings. The remaining 12,000 was for expenses. But we entirely took it to drawings account. So where did the error occur? Our entry was this, drawings account debited to bank. In bank, we have credited properly 20. But instead of debiting expense 12,000 and drawings 8,000, we have debited fully to drawings 20,000. So error is only in drawings account. Drawings was incorrectly debited to the extent of 12,000. So how will you remove the effect of that error? How will you rectify that error? By crediting drawings account to the extent of that error, which was 20,000 minus 12,000, which were for expense. So minus 3,000. You need not show this working also, it's already given 12,000 was for expenses. That way also you can take. So whom you have to debit, the reason why we actually withdrew the amount which was for expenses 12,000. This is the first rectification entry. Give the proper narration. I'm not going to record the narration for any of these entries. We will just discuss the entry and go ahead. But when you are writing it as part of your answer, you will have to write it along with the narration. Purchase of goods worth 16,000 was not recorded in the books of the accounts up to 31/3/2019. But the goods were included in stock, which means you have forgotten to record the purchase entry. But you have physically counted the stock and therefore closing stock is correct. So how will you rectify that error? You have to record the purchase entry. How will be the purchase entry? Purchase account debit. Creditors. 16,000. Here also give the proper narration. Then the third one. Purchase returns of 1,000. Was recorded in sales return journal and the amount was correctly posted to the party's account on correct site. Yeah, so we have discussed about that one. We will quickly have a discussion again. We have two books, purchase returns journal and sales returns journal. Yeah. Instead of recording it in purchase return journal, we recorded it in sales return journal. But from sales return journal, it went to two accounts. One to sales return account and other to the party account. Party account was same person. So party account. The party account, since it went from sales return journal, we should have actually credited party account. But party account was correctly posted, meaning to say, it had shown the correct effect of a purchase return. So purchase return account. So where did the error occur? The error occurred only in two ledgers, not in the party account. Party account was correctly done. So no effect in party accounts. Where were the errors? We forgot to mention the actual purchase return. That is one error. The second error was sales return, which shouldn't have been recorded, also got recorded. Now sales return, what is the effect of the entry if we had posted it? We would have taken to the debit of sales return because sales is credit and sales return is opposite of sales, which is debit. So sales return, I would have incorrectly debited. I have to reverse that. So I have to credit sales return. So I am crediting sales return. to the extent of 1000 rupees. Then what is the other error? I have omitted to record purchase return. Now I have to record that. Now purchase return is the opposite of purchases account. Purchase account, if it has a debit balance, purchase return account will have a credit balance. So I credit purchase return to show the actual effect of the purchase return that has taken place in my business. So I credit purchase return now 1000. Now, can we leave it as it is? No, it is a double entry system of bookkeeping that we follow and we learn throughout the subject. So therefore, if we credit both sales return and purchase return, the debit should have gone to which? Should have gone to only one ledger called suspense account. So suspense account 2000. Yeah. And then fourth, expenses include 6000 in respect of the period after 31st March 2019. So which means 2019, 31st March is the date for which you are supposed to prepare balance sheet P&L. So after that period, we have paid certain expenses or included, which means these are prepaid expenses. So how will you record it? Now expenses would have a debit balance. So if I have to eliminate it from the expense and move it to prepaid expense, I should credit the expense account. So two expenses, 6000, and I will debit the prepaid expenses, and this prepaid expenses have a debit balance and therefore it will be taken to my balance sheet as an asset for next year. Yeah. So these are the four rectification entry that we have to follow. We have to pass in order to correct all these errors. Now see, in all these four entries, only the third entry has a suspense account, and suspense is debited. Now come back to the trial balance. The trial balance has a suspense account of credit 2000. So this 2000 was recorded as part of suspense account in order to ensure that my trial balance is tally. Then we will go ahead. For that matter, we have updated the difference into suspense account. Now after recording the suspense account 2000 credit and tallying trial balance, we went ahead and found out the reasons for these differences cited here. After this reasons were found out, we posted the corrective measures or rectification entry. Now as part of this rectification entry, to be specific, as part of this third entry, the suspense account that we had credited with 2000 in order to tally our trial balance got cleared, because now we posted a debit of 2000 to suspense account to rectify all my errors, and hence my suspense account got cancelled and respective ledgers got created or added up or reduced accordingly. So all these ledgers will now be taken into trading P&L and balance sheet after taking into consideration these rectification entries. So suspense account, after these entries done are cleared, now we don't have to bother about this suspense account any longer. But you will have to remember one point. That is, when you take up ledgers from this trial balance except suspense account to be posted to either trading P&L or balance sheet, make sure to just revisit the rectification entries and see if you have to make any additions or subtractions and record accordingly. So let's move ahead with the rest of the question. In the books of T, we will quickly prepare trading P&L and balance sheet. Starting with opening stock. Given in the trial balance, opening stock was 60,000. Then we had purchases. Now we earnings share purchases given in the trial balance is 16 lakh, but revisit the rectification entries, you have an addition to purchase account again of 16,000. That's all. So make sure that you take into account. So purchase is 16 lakh plus 16,000. This amount omitted earlier, you can give an explanation as to why you are adding it. 16,000. So we have shown that effect. Then we had to record purchase returns. Now purchase returns in trial balance was 69,000. But revisit the rectification entry and we see that purchase return, another credit of 1,000 was also there. So 69,000 credit plus another 1,000 credit. So which means minus purchase returns, it's not just 69,000, another 1,000 also. So we can say 70,000 together. So therefore my net purchases is going to be 16 lakh plus 16,000 minus 70,000. We can say 15 lakh 46,000. Now we have to record sales. Now sales given in question is 22 lakh and sales return 99,000. But sales, anything in rectification entry is nothing. But sales return, we have a credit of 1,000. Generally, sales return have a debit balance. So if I have a rectification entry with sales return credit, it means my sales return should reduce to that reduce by that amount 1,000. So sales return is 19,000. So sales, I can say in our column, I'll write 22 lakh. For sales amount, there is no adjustment, only sales return. So minus sales return. 99,000 should have been the case, but I have to reduce another 1,000 and 90,000 will be reduced from total sale. So 22 lakh minus 98,000 is 21 lakh 2,000. And then any direct expenses we can quickly check. We have only expenses mentioned, you don't have any direct expenses. So which means expenses which is not specifically given or a hint as to whether it's a direct or indirect. If that is not specific in the question, always consider it to be an indirect expense. If it has to be taken as direct expense, it should be clearly mentioned in the question. Either freight inwards, the reason of those expenses, or it will be mentioned as direct expenses. If nothing is mentioned, all these expenses are indirect expenses. So trading account we can close after taking into consideration the closing stock. Closing stock is 1 lakh and that 1 lakh was correctly found out after considering this purchase also. So closing stock as it is 1 lakh we can take out. So by closing stock 1 lakh. And now let us find out the gross profit. So my net gross profit is 5,96,000 rupees. So I'm continuing on the right hand side of this answer, since I did not have space there, the rest of P&L account preparation. Now I have given a single heading trading and P&L for the year ended, but sometimes in study material generally they have shown trading account separately and P&L account separately. It is not a big difference, only separate ledgers they are open. You can collectively show trading and P&L account, and just like the previous question we have done, we can just continue with the same statement. That is also possible. So I am just going to do that again. That is the reason I do not write P&L account again in when I am moving on to the right hand side. That is only because of want of space here. So by gross profit, brought down 5,96,000. Then I have to record all indirect expenses and indirect income. Now, expenses given in the question was 50,000. Any other expenses? Then we have only depreciation. So, expenses is 50,000. So, if expenses is 50,000, check whether any rectification entry had an effect on expenses. Expenses was again added or debited 12,000. So, 50,000 plus 12,000. And then expenses were credited 6,000. Credited to the extent of 6,000. That means minus 6,000. So, I can say 50 plus 12 minus 6. So, therefore, you can say two expenses, 50,000 plus not recorded earlier, 12,000 minus prepaid, 6,000, we can say 56,000 is my net expenses. Okay. Moving on to other expenses. We have interest on fixed deposit, which is an income. So, interest on fixed deposit, indirect income, credit balance, we will take it to the credit side of P&L. So, by interest on fixed deposit, 20,000. And what else is given? We are talking about depreciation rent. Now, depreciation rent both are in the nature of expenses and loss. Now, rent, it is given 17 months in rent is given up to 31-8-2019. But how many months rent should we consider? We should consider rent only up to 31-3-2019. After that, 5 more months rent had been paid and it is shown in rent account, which is not current year's expense. Only current year expense and income gets recorded in my P&L. So that rent which you have paid for future years also will be eliminated from here and shown as prepaid rent. So to rent, 17,000 is what given in the trial balance, but from that you have to reduce the prepaid rent for how many months? 5 months, from April 2019 to August 2019. So April, May, June, July, August, 5 months. So if 17,000 I had paid for 17 months, how many will be for, or how much will be the rent for 5 months? 5,000. So I can see my rent for the year is 12,000. Then I had to record depreciation. Now, depreciation already given in trial balances. Already given in trial balances 14,000. Now, is there anything mentioned in the additional adjustments? Yes, depreciation is to be provided at 10% per annum on fixed assets purchased during the year. So, which means it is an indication that the depreciation given in the trial balance is only for the opening balance of fixed assets that were there from 1st April 2018. So, no depreciation was charged for additional purchases during the year in terms of fixed assets 2 lakh. For that, you have to compute depreciation. So, therefore, to depreciation, that also maybe we can show as a working note quickly. Depreciation already in trial balance 14,000, that is on opening balance. Depreciation on fixed assets purchased during the year, during 18-19 to be specific, on 1st October 2019, we purchased fixed assets worth 2 lakh rupees and depreciation is to be provided at 10% per annum. So we can see that this 2 lakh worth of fixed assets I had used or put to was ready for use only from the date of purchase, that is from October, November. So from October 1st, so we had used it for October, November, December, Jan, Feb and March, 6 months. So we can say only for 6 months depreciation can be charged. So 2 lakh into 10% for 6 months. So that is 10,000. So total depreciation is going to be 14,000 plus 10,000 put together, 24,000. So depreciation, give the reference of working note, you can say 24,000. Yeah. So depreciation is also recorded. Now what do we have to record? Is there anything mentioned? Now we have only rent, we have recorded investments and bank balance. Now investments is an asset. But investments are given with a percentage. Now what does that percentage indicate? It indicates the interest that you are going to receive from these investments. Now is there anything mentioned about the interest from investments? No, interest is mentioned, but it is related to the fixed deposit from with bank. So this is an additional interest that you are earning. Have you received it in cash? No, but it is still my income of current year, which I have to show as an indirect income in my books. So therefore, by interest on investment, I have to consider that also as part of my indirect income. Now I have invested on August 1st, 2018. So I should get interest only from August 1st. Now percentage of interest is 12%, but how much did I invest? I invested 2,50,000. Yeah, so I can say investments worth 2,50,000, I am supposed to get 12% out of it, but I have invested only from 1st August, so I will get only interest from 1st August, August, September, October, November, December, Jan, Feb and March, which is for 8 months. So therefore, I will get an interest to the extent of 20,000. But have I received it in cash? No. So it is a receivable, but it is my income of current year, hence to P&L. Now I have recorded all expenses and incomes given in the question. So let us see what is my profit or loss. So my profit is going to be 5,44,000. To net profit transfer to balance sheet, balancing figure 5,44,000. Now let us prepare the balance sheet. First we start with fixed assets. Now fixed assets opening balance, it was given as 1,40,000. Plus, we had opening 1,40,000. Then we had fixed assets additions 2 lakh. So, plus additions 2 lakh, which means our total assets are worth 3,40,000. From that, we have to reduce depreciation. But what all depreciation should be reduced? Already in trial balance, there was a depreciation to the extent of 14,000, and which it was mentioned not directly but indirectly that it belonged to opening balance. Why was it indirectly mentioned? They had asked in additional points to compute depreciation on the purchased fixed assets. So which means the depreciation given in trial balance belongs to the opening balance. So if it is already given in the opening balance or already given within the trial balance, it will have only one effect. And where will that effect go? That will go to the P&L account, and which we have already taken when we debited P&L with the total depreciation of 24,000. It is actually a combination of 14,000 in the trial balance plus 10,000 we additionally computed. So that one effect is already gone into P&L. So should you again take into balance sheet? No. So what depreciation will you take into balance sheet? Only the additional point which was given outside trial balance, and that we computed as 10,000. So that 10,000 alone you will have to reduce. So therefore 3,30,000. 1000. So fixed assets and depreciation are mentioned. Then we had debtors and all those assets. Let us record one by one. Debtors 2,50,000 and closing stock was 1,00,000. Debtors 2,50,000, stock 1,00,000. Then we had certain FD with bank, all those, let us record those as well. FD with bank was, I believe, 2,00,000, wasn't it? FD with bank 2,00,000. Investments 12% were 2,50,000. So we have to record all those. Those are all my assets. So FD with bank 2,00,000, 12% investments 2,50,000. Then we had cash and bank balance. We will have to record them as well. So what is the cash and bank balances? Bank balance only is given 1,69,000. That also will be recorded. So 1,69,000 bank balance. So after recording bank balance, we have certain prepaid expenses. Shouldn't that be recorded as part of my asset? Yes. What all were they? We had an investment interest on investment receivable. We had not received it, but it was my income, hence I had taken to P&L. What is the other effect in balance sheet? It will be shown as a receivable or accrued interest in my asset side. So accrued interest on investment. That is how it was recorded in P&L as an income. So that was 20,000. So we have taken the two effect of this additional interest, for which no other information directly was given, but just by giving the investments made date and the percentage of interest you are going to receive from them, it is an indication that you have to compute this interest, even though we have not received it or nothing mentioned about it in the question. Then we had certain prepaid expenses. So shouldn't we record them as well? Yes. So what are the prepaid expenses? Let us see. Now prepaid expenses. One prepaid expense we had recorded as part of our rectification entry, if you remember. That was 6,000. And then we had interest prepaid expenses for that 5 months. So that put together, we can say 6,000 plus 5,000 here. This 5,000 was with regards to rent. So both put together, we have prepaid expenses to the extent of 11,000. So after this, we move on to the liability side where we are going to record the capital account first. Now capital account, what is given in the trial balance, we have capital 6,00,000. We had drawings 70,000. But drawings, do we have any additional rectification entry? Yes, we had a credit of 12,000. So which means from the 70,000, you are supposed to do that adjustment. So capital is 6,00,000 and drawing 70,000 minus 12,000, we will have to take into account. So let us show that effect in our balance sheet as well. Capital 6,00,000 minus drawings. The drawings do not take the entire 70,000 as it is. From 70,000, show the effect of the rectification entry. Therefore, only 58,000 should get reduced, and add the net profit that you found out in previous stage, which was, I believe, 5,44,000. Add that net profit into this capital balance. So 5,44,000. So we can say $10,86,000 is my capital balance as on 31st March 2019. Then we have to record other liabilities. Creditors, we have 2,20,000. then we had cash is actually showing a credit balance, which they're trying to say cash generally doesn't have a credit balance, but it is an indication of cash overdraft. Yeah. So this also will be shown along with other liabilities as an overdrawn position. So creditors 2,20,000 we can take as it is, but check the rectification entry. And rectification entry creditors have at the 16,000. So therefore, we can say that creditors 2,20,000 was the balance given in trial balance. Along with that, you have to make an addition amount not recorded earlier or the purchases which was omitted, 16,000. So this two put together becomes my closing cash. And finally, cash creditors. And finally, we have a cash overdrawn position. So that also we will show cash overdrawn. Generally doesn't happen, but since it's given in the question, we will take as it is. So 8,000. So now let us see whether our balance sheet gets tallied. So 10,86,000 plus 2,36,000 is 8,000. So our total balance sheet is 13,30,000. So we get a tally balance sheet. With that, we complete this question. Now this final accounts question is a bit tricky in the sense we had both rectification of entries along with this final account. But in terms of the P&L preparation and trading account preparation, it is not as complex as the first question that we had taken. In first question, we had a lot of computations in the expenses and we had a lot of expenses and indirect incomes to record. But in second question that we have taken up from November 2020, the adjustments in trading and P&L account are limited or the expenses list are limited, but we have to remember rectification of entries chapter and connect it with whatever we have learned with regard to adjusted trial balance and how the suspense account already in trial balance get adjusted. All those things should come into our mind, only then we can complete this question. So once your rectification of entry part is thorough and clear to you, and if you can work out that effectively and correctly, then the rest of the problem is very simple. If you understood question number one, is fairly simple. Yeah. Well, make sure the rectification of entries affect whatever you have done before preparing trading and P&L account should all have an impact when you take up ledgers from the trial balance. So wherever these rectification entries are having an effect in certain ledgers, when you take it into trading P&L balance sheet, whichever may be the statement, consider these rectification entries effect also. So if you remember that, then this question is very easy. So I hope it is clear to you. So we have taken up both May and November 2020 RTP question, and it is kind of very important and complex question. So I hope it is clear. So all the very best to all of you who are attempting exam. Thank you for listening. Have a great day. Stay safe and see you.